All right, well, this one's next, and we'll end on Oyana. Worthless as a wife. Okay, who is this? Oh no, does he really think that? That's awful. Wait, who is that? Oh, it's him. Yeah, okay, I thought it was him. Wait. Worthless as a wife? What the f- is this from before or after her proposal? This has to be before, because her proposal was in the year, 4045. March of 4045. So this is before. Dear brother, how are you? Keeping busy, I hope? You said I could always write you for advice, no matter how weird it was, so, well, I'm calling you on that. It's about my wife. I don't know what the hell is up with her, and well, you've met her, you know how quiet she is. It's impossible to get her to actually tell me what's wrong. I'm really worried about her, and I don't know what to do. Here's some backstory. You know her, she's always being weird and introverted. It's charming, most of the time. Ever since she lost her job, though, it's been dialed up to 11. I encouraged her to take up this science project of hers right after because I figured she needed something to ease the transition. But it's been over a year now. I thought she would have found another job outside of engineering, or better yet, decide she's ready to have kids. Not just because of the motherhood credit, but given the extra hours I'm pulling to compensate, we sure could use it. I mean, it's not like I didn't know what I was getting into, marrying a girl 15 years younger than me. But the obsession can't be healthy. What happened a couple days ago finally freaked me out, and still does. Oh, really freaked me out, and still does. I got home at 9, as usual, expecting to see her working on whatever it is that she's working on, or watching a drama or something. Instead, she's in the kitchen, on her hands and knees, scrubbing the floor violently. And I mean, our kitchen really is a mess. Everything in the apartment is a mess. I'd clean it myself if I wasn't so dead exhausted after 12-hour workdays. It looked like she had put in a serious effort into cleaning up, which seemed good. Except, actually looking at her, she didn't really look okay at all. Then she looked up at me and suddenly starts to cry. Be honest with me, I'm worthless, aren't I? She asks me, totally out of nowhere. What the hell do you say to that? Of course not, I told her as immediately as I could. If she heard me, she didn't show any signs of it. Oh, worthless as a wife was her words, not his. I see. Okay, yeah, that paints it in a different light. I know I'm worthless as an engineer, or I would not have been fired. I'm worthless as a scientist, or my work would receive attention from people, she whimpered. I'm worthless as a wife too, aren't I? I guess it's hard even for her to be strong for so long. Yeah. Yeah. You're not, sweetie, I told her. I got her to get up and sit on the couch with me, because discussing things with her on the floor would just be impossible. I tried doing the usual thing where I hug her and rub her shoulders, but it didn't seem to help this time. Neither did arguing with her. Our apartment is a disaster. If I were better, it'd be clean, wouldn't it? You were surely disappointed about that, she said. You've been busy, I told her. I don't really understand why she hasn't been able to find the time. But I could hardly say yes, could I? We never eat together, either. We rarely talk. This is the most we've said to each other all month. It's my fault, she said. Do you have any idea what to say to that? I have no idea how you're supposed to reassure women when they're telling the truth like that. I mean, I knew I couldn't agree, but all I could think of to say was, no, it's not, which is pretty lame. So even she worried about those things. How long prior was the last time we even had sex? I'm worthless that way too, she said. Well, something's been on your mind the last few times we tried. It's okay, there's no pressure. Besides, it's not like we're newlyweds. That doesn't matter, that's no excuse, she said. Or have you just given up on me? You have given up on me, haven't you? I tried to say something, but she cut me off. I really am worthless, she cried. And now I'm merely wasting your time with whining, aren't I? You're not worthless, and you can always talk to me. That's what I'm here for, I responded. It sounded pathetic the moment I said it. What if I started cooking dinner for you? If I'm spending all of my time at home, I merely should be carrying my own weight, she said. You don't know how to cook, sweetie, and that's fine. I truly am worthless, she said loudly, and started to cry again. I was at a loss, and frankly, I'm still not sure if what I said was the right thing. It sounded idiotic at the time, and it sounds that way now, even though it got her to stop crying. If you know what I should have said, though, I'm all ears. Well, he's trying, at least. You can help out more with the cleaning, if you want, though. It would be nice. It looks like you've already done a lot of hard work, and I really appreciate that, dear. And if you want to, you know, I'm not going to complain. I stumbled over my words like an idiot. An idiot whose idea of comforting his wife is telling her to clean up and have sex with him. What the hell? Even if it did get her to stop crying, I don't know. I'm bad with women, clearly. Yeah, oh my god, dude, wow. I mean, at least he's trying, but... clean up and have sex with me. That is an interesting way to try to comfort your wife. It apparently worked, though? Okay. I can do that. I'd like to. It would make me feel less worthless, she said. And besides, I'm your wife. Well, it gave her a purpose. I guess that's good? I don't know. Then she wiped her tears from her eyes and gave me a really intense look. Do you want to? She asked. I'm not a young man anymore. It's not like that's really something I had in mind, especially seeing her like that. But how could I say no? She kissed me, and I got into it soon enough. Don't get me wrong, it's not as if I dislike kissing my cute 20-something wife and her soft lips. It's just the circumstances, you know? Sex is supposed to be all about connecting people, but it just made me think that I don't really get her. I have no idea what had triggered this. It's really hard not to think about what's going on in her head while she was doing that, and hell if I know. Connecting people. Is it really? I never thought of it like that. Maybe it's not so bad, though. It felt like she had passion again, at least. I guess it's because she felt like she had to overcompensate, but she took the lead, guiding my hand up her skirt. At the risk of being too graphic, she held my hand while I played with her and kissed me gently. It seemed very sweet of her. And he said, wow, he's sending this to his... Who's he sending this to again? Is this a little brother or his brother? Oh god, it's slow to scroll. He's sending this to his brother. Wow, that is, yeah, that's detailed. If my brother sent me anything like this, I would say, too much information, please stop. Where was I? Oh yes, we were at the part where he was telling his brother about how he was playing with his wife. After that, she went, Jesus, dude, you... Wait, is she reenacting, She's so ye. Wait, what is she reenacting? Dude, he's sending this to his brother. After that, she went down on me. Why is he sending this to his brother? Oh my god. Dude. I would be horrified reading this for my brother. I didn't really think anything about it while she was doing it, for obvious reasons. But after she was done, she sat on my lap and held my wrist tightly. And it occurred to me that this was the first time she'd given head in years. I really hope it wasn't for my sake, I don't know. Her eyes were still watering at that point, but she also refused to let go. I don't know what the hell to make of it. Oh wait, but she never mentioned that. That was so weird. It's kind of funny, but it's also really disturbing, because she was not doing well at all, and was not happy. And it's kind of weird and funny that he was telling his brother about how his wife was giving him head. Like, what the fuck? I don't even know what to make of that. It's been a couple days now, and the apartment is pretty much all clean. She took it really seriously, I guess. I'm still really worried about her. Even after that, we haven't communicated any better. If she feels worthless, is a clean apartment really going to make her feel like she has value again? I mean, I know she does, I just don't know how to convince her of it. I was thinking the same thing, it gave her purpose, but... But just temporary, right? I mean, it's her work with the radiation theory, whatever it's called. That is her true purpose. But I mean, I guess we already know she gets back on track and gets back to it. Of course, you idiot husband. Wait, what? I guess I'll get to that part in a second. On the other hand, I just realized the one thing right now that I didn't say to her, and I should go do that. So never mind. I guess I don't need to send this letter after all. Which is good, because it'd make the next family gathering weird if talking to my wife just made you think of your old brother's manhood. That would be gross. I mean, I sure don't want to think about yours either. Oh my god. Okay, I'm relieved he didn't send it. Okay. That would be gross. I mean, I sure don't want to think about yours either. Oh god. This is amazing. I don't know if I can keep reading without cracking up. Anyway, now I'm going to go tell her what she really needs to hear. That she should keep on doing her science thing, whatever the hell it is. That's probably the thing that'll make her feel like she's not worthless. If she believes it's important, then that's what she should dedicate herself to doing. That's less awkward and weird than household cleaning and sex, at least. I'll tell her that I'll keep supporting her in her struggle with that. I think that's what she was looking for this whole time. I'm glad I realized that. Love, even though I'm not sending this, Naemun. Well, if he figured it out in the end, that's good. He really is a good man after all. He is. He is. He's very bad at talking with his wife. And it sounds like his wife is really bad at talking with him. It sounds like they definitely have communication issues. But, yeah, they're a really nice couple. Okay. Oh, Hyun-ae from Mute. Wow, even more hostile than it was before. More hostile. From my internal log, 7:20 p.m. in the Hyo household during our family meeting. Seo Young, we've got a serious problem, I said immediately after appearing on her living room computer screen. Has the situation with the council gotten worse? She asked. Yes, obviously, I said, as if she couldn't tell. The very first meeting of the council after the election, and like suddenly Chief Counselor Ryu has dropped any pretense of civility. He rammed through a budget change that will cut security's budget in half. To give to the electoral monitors instead, immediately. This is the first meeting. Wait, you can't be serious, she said, shocked. That's impossible, we're already short-staffed as it is, we can't afford that. Well, yeah, and it turns out that the security veto isn't much good when one man has the power to both propose legislation and also override the veto, I said. At that moment, I felt overwhelmed by ire. I could barely even get in anything. Okay, they talked over me. The Council of the Mugunghwa literally fucking talked over me. The Counselor of Security the whole time. Of all the audacious, she said, looking as angry to hear that I... Wait. Looking as angry to hear that as I was to say... Wait, what? Oh, I'm misreading that. Looking as angry to hear that as I was to say it. I can't believe they do that to you. To you. And there's another thing here that isn't right, though, I started. What could be worse than showing you that kind of disrespect? She asked. Well, like, it was Ryu himself who proposed the legislation, I said, without even the slightest bit of argument from anyone but me. I don't understand, she said. I felt disappointed. She should have been able to catch what was weird about that immediately. Because when it comes to proposing legislation, he's just the Counselor of Captaincy, right? But that should be under the purview of the Counselor of State, I said. So he has him on his side, she said. That isn't unusual. Political alliances aren't weird. Certainly there's been legislation proposed by other counselors as a proxy for him before. But, like, now he's not even putting up that facade? What's weird is that apparently the entire council is literally eating out of his hand. If they're letting him overtly be responsible for proposing legislation, I said. Really? I had assumed that he'd been responsible for proposing legislation before, she said, still looking confused. Sure, the Unity Act, but that was something that was directly about him. I said, certain that was the only piece of legislation that he'd proposed himself, rather than getting one of the new counselors to do it. I ran a check through every single set of minutes of the new council to be sure. Certain enough, every act and amendment had been proposed by someone else. Really? She said, looking puzzled. Are you sure? That's weird. What's happening? Why is Xiao Young so puzzled? When she said that, I did another check of the data to be sure. Again, nothing proposed by him directly. I'm sure, I just checked, and despite there being pieces of legislation that were almost certainly his idea, none of them came from Chief Counselor Ryu himself. Every single one was proposed by one of those idiot new counselors. Then I suddenly stopped, my own phrasing making my slowest processes reanalyze my search conditions. They were faulty. Of course they were faulty. It was too narrow. What do you mean? Oh no, I said. Of course. You're right, Lieutenant. I'm getting too old for this. Too slow. I would have made the connection instantly when I was your age. The Meritocracy Act, right? She said. Of course. We even wondered at the time if it was a power play, didn't we? Yep, they did. Yeah, we did, but you thought it was out of character, I said, recalling that evening. Oh no, I'm so sorry. It's my fault, she started to say before I cut her off. No, of course not. It didn't seem plausible at the time. I still don't get how, like, if the exams were rigged somehow, surely Counselor O would still be on the council? He'd never give up his position, absolutely no matter what. Right, she said. I mean, that was the point of having them be held by the university, so the old counselor O could control them. Okay, like, what if he tried to, but someone beneath him refused to? I asked, processing out loud. He would have just assumed they were taking the moral high ground. Oh, and of course he wouldn't have said anything. He was a stupid man, but hardly stupid enough to raise an indignation about failing to fix exams, said Xiao Young, nodding. Wait a minute, hold on, I'm not getting this. There was a point of having them be held by the university so the old Counselor O could control them. Right, the old Counselor of Education. He was, O Yana's father. What if he tried to, but someone beneath him refused to? He would have assumed they were taking the moral high ground.
I don't get it.
Hmm. It doesn't matter, though. It's just a theory. It's not like we can act on that. We can't prove anything, I said. Well, maybe, she said quietly, looking away. Maybe what? I asked. Pardon me. Never mind. I'm sorry, ma'am. I was about to suggest something that you wouldn't like, she said softly. Lieutenant, tell me. That's an order. Let's at least hear it. Well, we could go through the logs of everyone at the university, see if anything incriminating comes up, she said quietly. We could not. Reading through the private documents of nobles, I said, shocked. That's absolutely impossible. Well, actually, you do have the root password, she said. She was clearly ashamed by the suggestion, but still going through with it. She was right, though. Well, I guess even back then she didn't do that. I'm gonna come back to this in a minute. Let's keep going for now, but I'm now very suspicious about something. It's illegal. And that's a line too far, Miss Hyo, I said sternly. I know, but what else can we do? We already know for sure that Ryu doesn't care about the law, she said. After a day where it had become clear that my political power had been reduced to nothing, it was hard to argue with that. I recalled the last time something this drastic happened, and like, that was definitely not resolved through legal means. It still made me deeply uncomfortable. Okay, you're right. We'll at least look through them, I said. If we find anything incriminating, Counselor Ryu, well, at least we'll know. I don't know what we'll do from there, but at least we'll know. Very well, she said, nodding a little. Right, well, it's going to take a while. Let's go through the files of every single person who was working for Mugunghwa University at the time, in sequential order. See if anything stands out, I said, and started the search. Okay, what the hell is up with all these nobles writing in Chinese? Like, so far, everyone has. I don't get it, I commented while running my analysis. How is this so widespread? I stopped mid-sentence. What is she? I don't know. I stopped mid-sentence. I hadn't found what I was looking for, but I'd found something even bigger while searching the files of Hyun-ae, the president of Mugunghwa University. I looked at Xiao Young. She seemed far too anxious to just tell her as is. This is going to take a while for me to find anything. You should go get some tea, I told her. If you say so, she said. She started to call out to Miss Lim, but I stopped her, telling her that she should make it herself. She didn't understand why, but she got up and went to do it. In a couple minutes, she returned. Anything yet? She asked. Pour the tea first, I told her firmly. All right, ma'am, she said, puzzled, but did it. This is a lot more gentle than I was expecting from her. Yes, it is. I didn't expect Mew to be this gentle. Now sit down and drink it, I said. She did. She seemed baffled, but a little bit calmer. Did you find anything yet? She asked. I don't have conclusive proof, but yes, like, as far as I can tell, for the past 6 years, Mugunghwa University President Hyun-ae has been having an illicit relationship with Chief Counselor Ryu, I said. But I found something even more important. Okay, remember Hyun-ae saying something about how Mute had found the relationship out, so then it was okay for them to make it public, because why not? What could be, she asked. Okay, before I say this, I just want you to know. I'm going to do whatever it takes to get through this, okay? I promise I'm going to stop at nothing to destroy this man and his awful political movement. Once and for all, do you understand? I said to her. We'll put this all right, okay? She stared at me, and as it expected, she started to get anxious again. What did you find, ma'am? Did you? She asked, her voice unsteady, almost certainly suspecting what I was going to say. Xiao Young, I know who killed your husband. Oh, wow. Who was it? Who was it? Ryu? Hyun-ae? Okay, well, that is the end of that block. I need to grab some more. Alright, let's grab the remaining three. Whoops. Let me go ahead and save it. Okay, yeah, I think I only have enough power for three. Yep. And one more. 1%. That's weird. Some of these are lighting up. Like, why are these lighting up, even though I've already read them, but others aren't? Weird. Okay, that's the remaining three. Yep. All the others are just video data, no data, corrupted data, bitmap data. I can't use them. Here we go. Memorial speech draft. The president's arrest. Politics makes strange bedfellows. Okay. Well, I know which one I'm ending on. This one, which is right before the big event. Yep. Oh shit, I forgot to come back to the thing I was going to talk about with that last thing that I was reading. Okay. Hyo So Young was talking about wanting the master password. Could she be the informant? But no, didn't they say they tried to get it out of him? We tried to get the password out of him, but the bitch is the only one that has it, the bitch being presumably Mute. They said him, not her. I don't think Hyo-so-young would do that. It doesn't seem like she would do that. It really does not. I don't think so. Alright. Memorial speech draft. So this is about Hyo-young's husband. Hi, I'm Park Chin-sung. If you don't know who I am, I'm the student representation... a representative, and in Professor Kim's absence, now acting president of academics against Neo-Confucianization. I think I got it. Acting president of academics against Neo-Confucianization. Boom, got it. I like to think we were close, but truthfully, I didn't know Professor Kim very well. I've only been a student for a mere 5 years, my entire adult lifetime, but for him, the time I knew him was a flash in the pan, a mere fraction of a 3-decade-long academic career. I can't say, however, the time in which I knew him was a time that he considered to be one of the most pivotal in his lifetime. The founding of AANC. He was the last holdout professor to teach classes exclusively using Korean script over Chinese script. His specialty was in Earth history. And where nobody else did, he recognized Mugunghwa University President Oh Yun-ah's program of promoting Neo-Confucian classics for what it is. A retrograde ideology with myriad problematic aspects, not least of all involving the intersectionality of classism and sexism. I guess he felt strongly about Chinese characters being stupid. Yes, he did. Wait a minute. That is probably why he was killed. He was impeding the progress of Yun-ah's social change programs, whatever you want to call them. Yep. That piece of shit. He is one of the smartest people I've ever known, both a mentor and a father figure to me. I don't know why, but he saw a lot in me. And I've struggled immensely to live up to his expectations. No doubt he would be disappointed in what I'm about to do, and it pains me to say this. As of today, academics against Neo-Confucianization will be officially disbanded. Professor Kim was an extraordinary and stubborn man who had the determination and charisma to fight to the end. He was unique in that regard, a pinnacle above all others. Nobody could possibly fill his shoes. Without him, AANC doesn't have the leadership or the clout to keep going on. In this past 2 months, I've tried my hardest, but the sad reality of the matter is, I have let him down, and cannot take the role of that extraordinary man. With nobody else willing or able to step up to that role, I'm afraid there's just no point in going on. To everyone who believed in me, I'm sorry. To everyone who believed in Professor Kim, I'm especially sorry. This is my failure, not his. I will, however... Well, that's nice, I guess. Yeah. I will, however, thank the university for graciously deciding, despite their disagreements, to dedicate this auditorium in memorial of him. I ask you not to remember him by what has happened to AANC in his absence, but to remember him for his willingness to fight for what he believed in, for his brilliance and compassion, for all the scholarship he contributed on the subject he loved, for his ability to inspire anyone to understand the importance of studying history. I'll end on this note. One day, when I was having an absolute misery of a time with some silly adolescent relationship problem, I confided in him, rambling for 2 whole hours about how I didn't know what to do, and could he offer me any advice. He listened to me. He listened to it all, very patiently, and when I was done, he was silent as he thought about it for a good while. Finally, he said to me, "Here's the most important thing, Mr. Park. For fuck's sakes, it's not always about being clever. You have to be decent to her. For fuck's sakes, it's not always about being clever. You have to be decent. It's easy to be angry, to cast blame, to be spiteful. But I hope if there's any way I can redeem myself in his eyes and live up to the standard he set, It's making sure his legacy is inspiring people to be critical, to be curious, but to above all else, always be decent. You have to be decent. Thank you. He sounds like a really cool person. Although his relationship with all of the maids kind of sits as a blemish on his you have to be decent thing, but I don't know. I don't know, maybe him and his wife had an open relationship or something? I don't know. Okay, we're almost done. God, we're almost done with all of these. I'm gonna be so sad when this is over. I wonder if this is actually the last day in the game. Is there a day 4? The president's arrest. From Hyo Seo Young. In my entire life, I've never had a more exhausting month. I'm supposed to be the second most powerful woman on the ship when it comes to security. Yet increasingly, I feel powerless and utterly drained. It is not as if I haven't dealt with serious crises before. Yet this is just one thing that I'm powerless against after another. I've completely hit a dead end in finding the bastard who murdered my husband. There have been flagrant acts of outright sabotage leading up to the election. Counselor Mute has been powerless to stop the council from enacting horrible legislation like the Unity Act. And then, while I was trying to enjoy a single night with my little girl, eating dinner, the last chance I will surely have before the election in 3 days, I cannot even do that without things somehow managing to become unimaginably worse. "Drop what you're doing right now," Mute yelled, suddenly appearing in my dining room without any warning. "There's no time to talk, but I need you and your best officers at the president's residences within like 5 minutes. "Is this about..." I started to ask, but was immediately interrupted. "I said no time to talk," she said, shouting more authoritatively than I've ever heard her in my life. "Call your men while you're walking. Okay, you've literally got 5 minutes to get there. In fact, don't walk, run. I'm not joking. Now, okay?" "Sorry, sweetie, mommy has to run," I told Sohai, then raced into action post-haste. I don't know how, but I managed to make it down in 5 minutes myself, somehow, to see Mute arguing loudly with a man in electoral monitor's uniform, with several more in tow. "Okay, good, my lieutenant's arrived. She can put up with your bullshit instead," she said. "Yes, ma'am," I said, catching my breath. "It was pretty bad. I'm way too old to be running like a young woman like that. My officers are on their way. They should be..." Never mind, there they are. I was probably joined by 3 men from one corridor, with several more running from the other direction. "You don't have jurisdiction here," the leader of the group of electoral monitors barked. "You cannot stop me, counselor. I have orders to arrest." "I have no patience for this. Take it from here, please, Seo Young," Mute said, disappearing from the outside screen. But then she said into my earpiece, "He's right, we don't. Stall for as long as you possibly can without breaking any laws." "Yes, ma'am," I said, nervous from lack of information. I still had no idea what the hell was going on at this point, although I would later learn that she was getting President Park to change the ship's root password so it at least couldn't be transferred to Chief Counselor Ryu.
Oh.
That must have been what they were talking about. They couldn't get the password from him. We had to get it from that bitch, or we can only get it from that bitch. Him being Park and that bitch being Mute. Huh. Well, smart, although in the end it didn't exactly work out all that great, but probably worked out better than it would have if they had the root password. "I just arrived. I'm not briefed," I said honestly, having no idea what was going on at this point. "What's going on?" "You do not have authority here. Step aside," he barked. I stared him down. I recognized him. He was a former security officer I had personally recommended be given to the Electoral Monitor Unit because he was useless, but too politically difficult to get rid of. He was allowed, but that was all he had going for him. Then I grabbed him by the collar. There was no way I could have actually overpowered a man his size, but I knew he was a coward, or at least I hoped my assessment was right. "Listen here, I'm going to say this once and only once," I said, having absolutely no clue what I was going to say. I'm under orders from the Counselor of Security not to let you through. If you try to go through me, I will have you arrested on the spot for interfering with security operations. By the time I finished saying that, all my officers had arrived, and I had a good 10 men and women, in various degrees of being uniformed and armed, standing beside me. "I'll have you arrested for," he started to yell. Then I realized what actually would do it and put him down quickly, interrupting. "Shut up, officer. I outrank you, and my orders outrank yours," I said, counting on the hope that he actually was following orders. "Let's be civilized and do this properly through the chain of command. Do you think either of our bosses wants to see an altercation between security forces? Just explain to me what's going on and you're in the right, and I'll let you through. And if you're in the right, I'll let you through. For the record, I'm absolutely confident that we could have taken them all down if we had come to a physical altercation. It would have been a truly bad idea to do so with serious political repercussions, but still, I'm certain we could have, for the record. The president and most of his campaign team is under arrest for conspiracy to commit electoral fraud," he said angrily, but not escalating things further, thankfully. "It should be obvious that this falls under our jurisdiction. You have no standing here." "Of course," I said. Really? They were going to arrest the president? That is a damn extreme thing to do, isn't it? Arresting the president.
"Of course," I said. Excuse me.
Oh, it's almost midnight. Pretty damn close to when I'm going to bed. Let me do a quick stretch. Okay, I'm good. "Of course," I said. "Just let me confirm that the arrest warrant is in order, and I will gladly stand aside." He seemed momentarily taken aback, so I kept talking. "You do have an arrest warrant, right? We're talking about the president himself here. A signed warrant from the Counselor of Justice is required by law," I said, counting on him not knowing that wasn't true. "I thought Mute didn't like the president, though. Why are they..." If you don't move out of the way now, I'll have you arrested," he scowled. "Mr. Hyo, listen to yourself," I said, scolding him in the same voice I use with my daughter and my maids. "I'm just concerned that you follow proper protocol. Do you think Chief Counselor Ryu," he suddenly flinched, "will ever promote you if you make a botched job out of the most high-profile arrest in the ship's history? I will ask you again, one last time, for your own sake. Do you have all the paperwork from the Counselor of Justice in order?" He started, then stopped. "I'll confirm it with him. None of you move," he shouted at his officers, then stepped aside to talk privately on his earpiece, presumably to the Counselor of Justice, while all his officers tried their hardest to stare down mine. Only when his back was turned did I let myself exhale a sigh of relief. No officer I would have trusted with something so important would have flinched like that. "Ma'am," I said, quietly into my own earpiece, "if you need more than a minute, I can do that, but I think it will very rapidly get unpleasant." "Do not use violence, Xiao Young. Absolutely do not, under any circumstances, use violence, okay?" "Understood, ma'am, but that's all I can do at this point," I said. "Sorry, he's back." The electoral monitor returned, with slightly less of a scowl before. "The Counselor of Justice confirmed that everything is in order. He also gave me permission to arrest anyone standing in the way of executing the warrant. Chief security officer or not," he said smugly. "Very well," I said, trying to think of something else I could say or do. I couldn't, short of punching him in his smug jaw as he deserved. I spoke into my headset right in front of his face. "Ma'am, if you don't respond now, I'm going to have no choice." She reappeared on the screen outside the president's door. "Okay, there's no need for any trouble here. He's on his way out right now and will be surrendering peacefully," Counselor Mute announced to him. "Mr. Hyo, I trust that won't be a problem." "He has 1 minute, Counselor," he said. It was almost certainly the most intense minute of my entire life. Everything was silent, every party involved trying to stare down the other. But sure enough, after a minute, President Park emerged. "For the record, I strongly protest this outrageous, fascist circumvention of the democratic process," he declared loudly. "But I will peacefully surrender in the hope that this is dealt with swiftly." "As if you can say that, you traitorous scum. You're the one planning to fix the elections and orchestrating acts of sabotage. If there's any justice, you'll die in prison. The electoral monitor snapped, as one of his men handcuffed the president. Mr. Hyo, my department will be supervising President Park every step of the way. Like, let your boss know that if he's even treated slightly improperly, I'll know about it right away, okay? Mute said, just so we're absolutely clear. Just don't interfere, he said. Take him away. From that point onwards, it was, as President Park himself would call it, an utter shit show. And to think that circumstances would actually cause us to side with that man on anything. But in the end, there was nothing that could be done. I could see it in Mute's eyes that for once, she too had felt as though she could only accept defeat this time. I don't understand what just happened, I said to her after the arrest was made and the president was locked up for the night. Me neither, was all she said, without any confidence. I'm scared, ma'am, I admitted. Yeah, she said, not elaborating any further. Yeah. With everything that happened that night, supervising the arrest powerlessly, I couldn't even make it home until late at night, far past the hour anyone was awake. I went to check on my daughter, peacefully asleep, already tucked in by one of the maids. Then I fell to my knees and lamented that I was so powerless. I couldn't have even been there to do that for her. Damn. Okay, here's the last one. Politics makes strange bedfellows. Seriously, I'm really tired. Damn. Wake up. Let me shake my head. There we go. Okay, shaking your head always wakes you up, at least for a couple seconds. Okay. Like, I'm starting to mispronounce a lot of words and misspeak constantly, a lot more than I usually do, I think. Okay. Come on. Politics Makes Strange Bedfellows by Hyo Seo Young, which is very close to the Year Zero Reset thing. This has a different feeling than the other log with him. We met former Chief Counselor Smith at Royal. The same place we did 7 years ago. In the same private room as before. This time, though, Mute arrived exactly on schedule. You know, ladies, I don't envy you at all, he said. It's so nice to look at what's happened to the Mugunghwa Council and think, not my problem anymore. The last time I saw you, Miss Hyo, you still had black hair. I'll sleep when I'm dead, I said. I don't have the time for it otherwise. How's your family? Mute asked, politely. It must be nice to have as much time as you want to spend with them. Oh, please, like either of you care about my family, he scoffed. I still keep up with current events, you know. I know exactly why you're here. You screwed up and your poster boy for mediocrity didn't turn out the way you planned, did he? He looked at me, expecting a response. I guess last time I was easily baited by him, not this time. I let Counselor Mute do the talking. She had far more confidence than I was able to muster anymore. Yep, we sure did, she said, smiling. No yelling, no denial, no insults, no sass. You must be desperate if you're willing to admit that right off, he said, actually taken aback by her honesty. We created a monster, plain and simple, she said, stifling a look of annoyance. It was a bad call. Who could have known underneath all that shy uselessness was a secret totalitarian. There we go. Almost stumbled on that word, too. He's out of control, I said, trying to restrain too much of my scorn for the man who had a part in murdering my own husband. Wait. Wait, who? Who's she talking about? Trying to restrain too much of my scorn for the man who had a part in murdering my own husband. Does she mean the person she's talking to right now, Smith? Or does she mean Park? He really is, Mute. Mute said. What do you want from me? I have no political power anymore. These young men that have taken over politics, there's no place anymore for old men like me. You still look young to me, she said. Then the conversation paused briefly as we ordered food, wine being poured for both Smith and I. Well, we can't all live forever. I guess it must be a lot worse to be an old woman in politics than an old man these days. He said, honestly though, I might seem like I've gotten softer, but I still hate your guts, Counselor Mute. I still hate your guts. Counselor Mute, you were the biggest pain in my ass for my entire career. I think you've got what you had coming. Good, I'd have no use for you if you didn't. Mr. Smith, I'm about to propose something absolutely crazy, okay? And the only way we'll ever be able to pull it off is if even someone who hates me is on board with it, she said. And I know what you care about at heart is the best interests of the ship. You're wrong, what I care about are the best interests of my grandchildren. Oh, don't be pedantic. They align and you know it. Like, do you think this is just an abstract point to me? I've got children in my family too. You know. Ensuring a safer future for the ship means ensuring a safer future for my family, my family's little so high, and your girls too, Mute said. In that moment, I admired her more than I ever had. I knew she cared. But I'd never heard her speak about my daughter in such affectionate terms before. I could tell she wasn't just saying that for Smith's sake, and it was an awfully sweet sentiment of her to express. Huh, she could be a smooth talker, though. Yes, she can. Fine, what's your proposal? He asked. You've got until we finish eating to convince me. I'm going to be up front. What I'm proposing is nothing short of an armed... Oh god, I don't remember to pronounce that. Coup... Coup something. I want to depose Chief Counselor Ryu and his entire council of destructive yes-men before he manages to completely gut ship security for good, Mute said, pounding her fist into her palm. I'm willing to stake everything on this. You're serious, Smith said, actually taken aback. Whoa, a rebellion? Mute? Yep. She started a rebellion. And it almost worked. It almost worked.
Okay, good.
I finally got your attention, she smirked. She explained the situation in detail, the culture of the new council, the slow manipulation over the course of the past 7 years, the conspiracy, the private army of electoral monitors, the engineering of his victory in the election by arresting the president, the murder of the one man good enough to stand up to Ryu's conspirator and plaything at the university. Whoops, oh shit, I did not mean to do that. So I guess this is it then. No, hold on. No, that's not it yet. Where was I? About halfway? Here we go. She really idolized her, huh? Ryu's conspirator and plaything at the university, yep. She was really fired up. It reminded me of the good old days, when our problems were so much simpler. When I was still young. She still had that beautiful golden hair, and we were too strong to be scared of anything. I saw that in her again, listening to her speak like that, so impassioned, so cool. I just knew, at her side, we could put things right. Finally, she finished. And there was a long pause. Do you really think you can pull it off? He asked at last. I'll let my lieutenant field this one, she said. Miss Yeo, I tried to muster up the same confidence in my voice that she had. Unambiguously, I said. I know my men and women very well. They are both well-trained and loyal. I've made discreet inquiries and have already put together a list of 300 officers that I'm prepared to trust with my life. Ever since word got out that Chief Counselor Ryu plans to slash our budget in half to bolster his own private army of electoral monitors, he has been an extremely unpopular man in security. This is dependent on us acting swiftly, though. Right now, we outnumber them nearly 7-1. But that advantage is going to become narrower and narrower the more the Chief Counselor attempts to starve our department. As well, Oyanam must be aware we're onto her, given the sudden public reveal of her relationship with Ryu, I told him. But if we are to strike swiftly and catch them off guard, at our strongest, I have no doubt that we'll be able to assume control within a day. Even if I'm convinced that such drastic measures are really necessary, do you really expect me to take the risk of supporting you? He asked. Nope, I don't want you to. It'll look bad. Mute said immediately. I want no part of the revolution to be traceable back to you. What I want are a set of faces I can trust to form the Mugunghwa High Council. You want me to be your new chief counselor, he said. I want the past 7 years to have never happened, you said. I'll settle for putting the council back the way it should have been. I want you to be the old chief counselor, and I want to have those argumentative idiots back on the council, like even Gim and Oh. I know you can do that for me. What if I refuse, he asked. Then nothing happens. I won't have Ryu replaced with someone I can't trust. That isn't a mistake I'm going to make twice, she said flatly. You refuse, then we walk away. A good man dies for nothing, and your grandchildren grow up in a totalitarian, neo-Confucian dystopia. It's your call. Mute. She really wanted to prevent that. Yeah. Yep. But it didn't work. He paused, pensive. You really think you'll be able to pull this off, Counselor Mute? He finally asked. With a single elegant gesture, she produced a cigarette and lit it, taking a drag and blowing it dramatically. It was the coolest. In that moment, I knew that she was the same old badass Mute that I always believed in. Just watch me, Mr. Smith, she said, projecting the utmost confidence. By the end of the dinner, we'd gotten him to pledge to leave retirement once we were successful. Wow, I got chills from that end. Even though I know how what they did worked out, or rather that I know what happened and I know that it didn't work out, even though I know that, I still got chills from that. I think I understand what she saw in Mute now. Yeah. I think I do too. So, I guess this is it then. Yeah. So, we've read everything we can before we return. Oh my god. Let me try that again, but this time with more talking and less fumbling. We've read everything we can before we return to Earth, I suppose. Thank you, Mr. Investigator, for letting me play your sidekick. Oh, you... No need to thank me. Thank you for coming along with me. That was awesome. The past 3 days could have been really hard on me, but instead, I got to experience what your job is like. And more importantly, we were finally able to solve the mystery of what happened in the year zero. Yep. We did. God, I just keep thinking of all the little threads of these people's lives. I mean, I guess I shouldn't start reminiscing until I've actually finished the game. Okay, I'll get back to that. It's still really hard for me to parse and understand, yeah. And really, there's just so much I don't know how to deal with. Yeah. I feel the same way. But I think it's really important that I now know. So, tell me. How do you feel about what we've read? I hate everyone equally. Well, no. I do dislike Mute. I still don't like her, but I appreciate her a lot more now. I'm sympathetic. Yeah, it's hard not to. Even to someone like Hyun-ae, someone who is responsible for so many horrible things. Well, I guess I can understand doing something horrible because you feel trapped, is all I mean. Yeah. I hate her, but I get it to some degree. Well, changing the subject to something less heavy. What do you think of the past 3 days, though? Do I make a good sidekick? Yes. You are an adorable companion. That's true. But more importantly, you're the best. Ah, thank you. I know I still have a lot to learn, but I can't wait to do it by your side. I just knew we made a good team. Even just out here, together. Anyway. Wait, what are you gonna ask? I guess I'll try asking one more time. Please, this time, I need a firm answer. Okay? What? Will you get me a body, please? Yes, of course. Oh, thank you. Thank you so much. After 622 long years, I'll have a body once again. Oh, what a wonderful thought. Things will finally maybe be the way they always should have been. I'll get to relearn what touch is like. There's a lot of difficult things that will still be in my way, but still, I'm looking forward to it. So, I saw that message you got, the one that was in Korean from the Historical Society. I know that it said they wanted me to testify. Okay, I figured you would have read it. I've been really nervous to mention it because the idea is so scary, but... Are you going to make me do what they asked? Will you make me testify about the Mugunghwa? What I did? No, I'm not going to make you. It's up to you. Ah, that's a really tough decision. Yeah. Just, I can't say anything other than, yeah. Thank you for trusting me to make it. I think, if you were at my side, I think I might be able to. I guess it's important that everyone knows the truth about what happened on the Mugunghwa, and I was part of that. Yeah, it's not gonna be a pretty tale, it's gonna be hard as hell to get through, but people need to know. But only if you're by my side. Otherwise, I'd never have the strength to go in front of a bunch of Inquisitors alone. But if you were there, I think I'd have the strength. That's how you make me feel. Well, anyway, I suppose it's now almost time to begin Star System Entry procedures. Yep. I just don't want the game to end. Even from out here, I can see Earth on the visual sensors and... It's gorgeous. Gorgeous, isn't it? Wow. No matter what happens, no matter how bad I feel about what I've learned, no matter how much I need to learn about people, no matter how hard it is to be a proper adult, no matter what, I'm going to take all the things that shaped me, that shaped what kind of ship I grew up on, and I'm going to try to put them behind me. Even if there's still so much ahead of me, thank you so much for rescuing me. Thank you for being here for me. Thank you for saving me from that prison and putting up with me. I know it seemed really sudden when I confessed, but the fact that you're that kind of person, I still love you for that. From now on, I'm going to look forwards towards the future, towards that gorgeous blue planet. I'm sure I won't be able to look back with you by my side. Okay, the game's not over! It's not over! Power down until tomorrow, unless that is the end of the game? Powering down? I don't think so. Pretty sure it's not. I hope that's not the end. Okay. Pretty sure it'll give me a save in just a second, but just in case. Power down until tomorrow. Are you sure you want to shut down for today? Yep. Good night, Hyun-ae. It has been one hell of a day. It started with cake baking, which was wonderful. And it ended... Well... A big, melty pot full of tragedy and love. Yeah. Good night. I guess that's all, then. Next time we talk... We'll be on Earth. I can't wait. I can't wait.
Neither can I.
Oh, fuck, that is the end. Oh, shit. Ah, it is the end. It is the end. Story and code, Christine Love. Main art by Raid Ride. However you pronounce that. Ride.
Aww.
I'm so sad that it's over. Okay, yeah, so what I was reminiscing on before, I was thinking that it's just so sad to think of all of the little threads of people's lives that I looked at. Like the one between Mimi and I forgot his name again. It had Bach in the name, I think. But the relationship between Mimi and him, and the last message I read, the last one that was there, was him having to marry someone that he didn't care for just for the money, and that ruining the relationship. That's so sad, and that's the last thing I read. And that's it. That's forever in the past. I'll never know what happened. Did they ever get back together? I don't know. Probably not. But I'll never know. And then there's the So-chin, the flower girl, and the actor. Their relationship, which was so beautiful, but then ended so horribly. And she still keeps the hair clip in her hair. Just thinking of the hair clip again made me cry. That hair clip. I'm thinking of her having that hair clip for like the rest of her life. That's so fucking sad. And, Hyun-ae's younger sister. Her killing herself. And the engineer. At least her story wasn't completely sad. What she wanted to do most, present her research, that was her purpose in life, is presenting her research, discovering, fleshing out her ideas, and finally presenting them for the good of the ship, and doing something good. That was just completely ignored or buried or whatever. Either way, nothing ever became of it. That's so sad. The good thing is, though, she has a good husband. But still, her main purpose in life, shot down. I can't help but cry thinking of all of it. Well, now we know what led up to Year Zero. Yep. God, I kind of want to talk about some of the changes in this game from the last one, and like talk about mechanics and stuff from like a, I don't know, game design standpoint or whatever, but I don't think I can do that while I'm crying. So I guess I'll just leave that out. But just speaking about 8 plus, character wise, story wise, emotionally speaking, it's really strange. What am I trying to say? Hold on, let me collect my thoughts. It's a good way to round off the series. Like the last, I don't even know if it is going to be a series. Like, I don't know if there's going to be other games set in that continue the story or what. She totally could. I don't know. It just feels like it's been ended, though. Like, you know, it feels like it's been rounded off. Because, I mean, you discovered her in the first game. You discovered her, and you rescued her. And in the second one, You take her to Earth, and you're going to put her into a real body, and she's going to become what she always wanted to be. An adult woman who can do what she wants, and she isn't stuck in this fucked up patriarchal society that doesn't give a flying crap about her, and isn't stuck in a sick body that's dying. She's finally free of that. So it feels like the story's been wrapped off, you know? It really does feel like it's ended. She could continue it, but I suspect she won't. I don't know, that's just... I have no idea. We'll just have to see what happens. But yeah, it's... Everything I read about, some of it was so sad, some of it was so sweet. It's just... Christine Love is so good at writing things that are just a mixture of cute and sweet and just horrible and tragic. That just leaves me feeling emotionally drained in ways that I just don't normally feel. Again, all those little threads and all those ruined relationships. That's horrible. But then there's all the good. There was a lot of good. Alright, well. It is, Oh, it is exactly midnight in like a minute. Wow. That is the end of Hate Plus. We finally found out what happened leading up to the year zero. And we took Hyun-ae to Earth. And we're going to give her a proper body. I'm satisfied with that. But it doesn't stop me from being depressed about everything that happened and that this experience is over. But you know, I know there's multiple pathways through the game. Well, actually through the games. Both the games. So I might actually try to explore other paths. I'm not sure. We'll see. But nonetheless, I'm really happy with the path I took. Alright. Well, that is the end of Hate Plus. I hope everyone has enjoyed. And that's it. It's hard for me to stop recording. I don't want to stop. I don't want to say goodbye, but that's it. Let's click through this, see if anything happens. Aww, is that her in her new body? I think it is. Yep, it is. It's beautiful. Now, what is that? What is she? She's... Oh, is that her, giving her speech? Not her speech, her testimony? I think that is her giving her testimony. That looks like, it looks like they're taking it down for the record or something like that. Aww. Survivor's testimony ending. End of day 3. Thanks for playing. I wonder how many other endings there are. I'm really curious. But nonetheless, no matter, even if I do experience the other endings, even if I do record them and put them up, and I don't know if I will or even if I'll do them, but even if I do, none of that changes the fact that this is my ending. You know, this is my personal ending. It's the one I chose to go through. It's the first one. So this is going to be the one that I go with, even if I do explore the others. This is my ending. Survivor's testimony ending. See you, Space Investigator. Achievement unlocked. Relationship status. It's complicated. Okay. Now I'm actually gonna end it. Alright. Need to stop recording. Need to let go. Need to let go, Marshall. Stop recording. Stop recording. Okay. I hope everyone enjoyed. Goodbye.